Good morning, 431 in your hymnal, saved, saved, 431. Let's all stand, shall we? Page 431, I found a fellowship song. Second. He saves me from every sin and bar, secures my soul each day. I'm leaning strong on his mighty bar. I know he'll guide me all the way.
Good morning. How many of you are glad you're here? A couple of you. Want to read you a card real quick. Dear church family, that's you. We would like to take the time to thank everyone for the prayers and all the support through this difficult time. Diana would have been so pleased with it all. Thank you, ladies, for the dinner. Everything was great. In Christ, the family of Diana Barden. That, of course, is Rod Lowry and Wendell Lowry's sister who went to heaven. You know, isn't it a good thing that Christians go to heaven? Amen. And I'll say it, and it's true, that I've been around in my 35 years of ministry. I've been around a couple of people in the last moments, And when they're a Christian, it's always good. I've never been around any one of them that said, no, no, no. I've been around them that were mad that they didn't go sooner. So I'm thinking, there's something to this heaven thing. And I'm glad God does that, because that makes it easier for those of us left knowing. I don't know how I'm going to go, but I know where I'm going. I don't have to worry about that. I mean, I want to go eating. My dad used to say that, cutting hair. My son's praying I die right here. And I would go, Dad, tell him you want to die cutting hair. Like, I'm not praying he'll die. But he would. I'd walk in and go, my son's praying I die right here. And he wanted to die cutting hair. He didn't, but you know what I mean? You know what I mean? Many are sick. Pray for them. Fred is, I think he just had too much of Chris. He has positional vertigo. And some of you, if you've ever had vertigo, when I was in college, when all my ear problems started in college, mine wasn't, it was vertigo, but it was a disease eating my eardrum and my bones. And I couldn't walk. I crawled around the house to get around. Now I'm used to it. I'm dizzy all the time, but I'm used to it. But that feeling with the nausea. So you pray for Fred real hard, would you? Others have been sick. We've been praying for you, and there's some sick. We're praying for them. Brandy had surgery, and she's out. Everything went well enough. The Yelskis are back from Florida. Don Hall is back from Florida. He said they were down there. They're in the hospital most of the time. They were sick. They're in bed. They didn't get to enjoy it. So that's a sign from God. Don't go to Florida. Stay here. Look how nice the weather is here. It's going to be 87 here today. Or so. So just enjoy it. Jim Keller's back from La Paz. Kathy's here again. Take care of. That's great. I'm glad he gets to come. I miss him. Thank you. Thank you. If you pray, thank you. I'll take prayer over anything. Amen. Thank you. Pray with me. Father, we have to be humble as we think about entering into your presence. That when I bow my head and address you, you're there. I read this morning that he hears me. And that humbles me to think that I can talk to you and you'll hear me. So help me pray, Lord. If I'm going to talk to you, I need help. I might as well get it from you. Help me, Holy Spirit, help me pray. Work today. Thank you for those who were sick and now are well. There are some still not well. God, help them. Help Fred. There are others, Lord. I think of Rich Annis. Give him complete. Please give him complete recovery. Lord, there are others that are still mending and still fighting, still wondering what's going on. But God, you know about it. You can give us the grace to get through it. Thank you for this day, Lord. May we rejoice. May we praise you. And may we look for what you're trying to say to us. That's why we're here. We want to give you all we can, but there's something you want to do in our life. Help us to see it. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You could be seated.
Page 413, Love Lifted Me, 413.
Yeah.
Well, is it just me? Is that good? Is it very good? Man, thank the Lord. Thank the Lord he's there. Thank the Lord that he rescued us. He heard, we sang, he heard my despairing cry. Wow, I'm so thankful. I need to be more thankful. I need to just, it's about him. We want it to be about us. I want it to be about me, but it's about him. If you have a bulletin, note, please, choir.
Yes.
Choir at 5, evening service at 6. The evening service is for us. It's free. We don't charge. Sunday nights, we're here about 10 minutes. Okay, 15. But you need it. Just remember, the length of the sermon depends on the need of the hearer. I should be going 2 days. Just reaching for it. You can see the visual, can't you? I don't even have to reach for it anymore. On the back side, Wednesday, we're here, midweek service, King's Kids Youth Group, Daylight Savings Time. Praise the Lord. We're heading to summer. We've had great weather, right? Thank the Lord. On the 14th, that is a week from Tuesday, the ladies' birthday dinner at Logan's. There is a sign-up sheet. If you have questions, you can check with my dear wife. And then on the 16th, that is not this coming week, the following week, the ladies are doing lunch. They'll let you know where, but just so that you're aware of those times so that you can schedule them in. The ushers are coming. Thank you for coming. Carol Klingenpeel is sick. Others, just if you don't see them, they've probably got it. And then it doesn't go away. It just stays. And you know why? Because we haven't had that good below zero weather to kill everything. I'm not sure what crocuses are, but the crocuses are blooming, whatever those are. I'm taking it. There's some kind of a plant. I don't know what they are. Like those flowers. I bought Amy roses, and they're still alive. Are those fake? They look good. I bought Amy roses, and they're still alive. Every time for the past several years, I buy roses, and they die. I don't know if it's me breathing on them, but I'll get them, and she'll wake up, and they'll all be like this. But they're beautiful. I had them. I got them on the way home from the funeral yesterday. Bought her. She doesn't like them. She didn't really care for roses. She likes flowers. She is not a big rose person, but I like them. And they were cheap. They had a deal on them, so. Hey, remember, if you're not going to buy them roses when they're alive, don't waste the money and buy them when they're gone. So she's enjoying them. And I bought her a bag of York mint patties shaped like Easter eggs. She's more excited about that. Hello. Thank you. Thank you. We went out. She got home. She was pushed. I had to finish up. About 8 o'clock, we went out. We went out the day before, but I said, let's go out tonight. I had got my work done. And so we went to Maxie's Barn. That place is good. We don't go there enough, if you know where that is. But we went in the door. Of course, we knew the gal that was hosting is from Lakeville. And then a family walked in that I knew. He's a undertaker. Has a funeral home in Laporte. And so we talked, and I said, how long? We just want dessert. We're just going to, can we do that? She said, we're packed. There's a half hour wait. I said, it's 8 o'clock. She said, we're just packed. I said, well, we'll wait. So we waited and sat down and I felt bad just getting dessert, so we got French fries with cheese and bacon on it. That was good. And then I said, what do you have for dessert? She said, we have turtle pie and Oreo pie. I said, one of each. So we ate those, and they both were just awful. Awful good. So thank you. Pray for Amy. Can you imagine being married to this for 39 years? That's why she's godly. If you ever want to know why she's godly, it's not because of me. It's because of me. Really, I'm serious. Ready to pray? Pray. Did Debbie Arnold go back yet? Is she traveling or we need to pray? She'll be going back. Pray for Rod and Wendell's sister came for the funeral. Pray for her safety and sweet family. I was impressed with Michelle and Tim. And Tim's mom came up to me that Diana, Rod and Wendell's sister, her daughter, Michelle, the mom, her mother-in-law came up and said, would you pray for my husband? He has bladder cancer. So I had my little pad I wrote down. I said, let's pray right now. She looked up. She said, I'm Methodist. I'm not used to that. I said, well, you ought to come here and get used to it. And I thought, ooh, I should have said that. But what, are the Methodists going to send their mafia after me? You pray for him. Ted Radinsky. Radinsky. Pray for him. He has bladder cancer. I think, huh? I made quite an impression. There's a big difference. One gal came up. She said, that's the best funeral I've ever been to. I started laughing. Because, you know, it's like saying, man, I got my tooth pulled. Best time I ever had. And I don't know who it was, but I said, hey, you know why? Because we're celebrating heaven. You know, and it is a sad time. Anyways, we're going to pray for him, put him on our prayer list. But you pray for him. You know, God moves people past us and moves us past people for a reason. You know, and I'm just thankful that I can, you know, pray like that and God can hear and do. He may want to do something else, but he was here then. I said, are you Ted? I saw him. I said, are you Ted? Yeah. I said, hey, I'm going to pray for you. I'm praying, you know, you've got this black. He said, thank you. You never know. Man, I'd want somebody praying for me. You never know. God left us here to tell people the good news. Listen, are you listening? If it doesn't look like we know the good news, they're not going to listen. Huh? You got to look like it. How you doing? Oh, yeah, I got to go to church. Why would anybody want to listen to you then when you go, oh, let me tell you about heaven? Man, you know, there's got to be something there. Y'all be able to, listen to me. God's worked on me about that. People should want to listen to us because they see us. And we don't go, here, we had them here, read this. You think they're like, okay, good. This must be good because you're very excited about it. But just go, hey, man, this has changed my life. Can I give you something to read? And people want their lives changed. But he changed my life. Amen. Ready yet? Ready to pray yet? Dear Father, thank you for sending Jesus. Help us to realize our accountability to live like he came and died, rose from the dead, and now lives in us. Help us to live like that. Help us to be excited about that. Thank you, Lord, that you would use us, that you would hear us, that you would care about us, that you would think about us. We're on your mind all the time because you're God. You can do that. Thank you. I praise you, Lord. I want you to work today. I'm sure there are those that want to be here. Maybe they're watching online. That's good. We'd love to have them here. But you speak to them. I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come on up, Amy. I know you love to be up here, and he always loves to have you up here. We sang to them last week. This week, we're going to really honor their anniversary. But before we do that, I'd like to say a few things about the pastor. Come on up, Amy.
Stand right by him.
You've heard this before, but this man is, in my view, the best Bible preacher. I mean Bible preacher. He's also the loudest preacher I've ever had. But he's the best consistent Bible teacher that I've ever had in my 46 years of being saved. Now, after saying that, there's a but. But he has some issues. And if you've been here very long, you know him. He doesn't keep them a secret. He tells us some of these issues. Some of them we saw already. He can't get up here without talking about food. He's already done it. He'll probably have something else in the message. It's always chocolate, pizza, or some other kind of food. Always. Watch for it. Don't take my word for it. Just listen for it. But have you heard this phrase? Now, don't get ahead of me. Read at my pace. Ever heard that? When you have your sermon, then you can go at your pace. I'm not going to tell.
I hate it.
There's no lies involved here. This is all the truth. He freely admits that he's impatient. But a lot of us are impatient too. He claims to be working on it. But are you working on your patience? My wife's not. But we all should be.
Amen. Wow. Take the heat off me for a minute.
He freely admitted he did it already this morning. He's a difficult man to live with, and nobody argues with that. He says that over and over. He's afraid of the dark. If there's bugs or spiders in the house, she has to kill them. He has that wild imagination that he already talked about this morning. A headache is automatically a tumor. If he has indigestion, it's a heart attack. A paper cut, you have to go to the hospital.
Ouch.
All these things create a lot of stress on Amy. They have to. They have to. So, Amy, I'm sure you're going to have an extra crown in heaven. Amen. When you get there. She still loves this man after 39 years. This guy with all these issues. And there are more of them I couldn't even think of. But we ought to have her come up and talk about him sometime. So, anyhow.
How about talking to you?
Happy anniversary, and we love you both.
Yeah, thank you. You want to open it now?
It's up to you.
You want to open it? I can't wait.
Well, most of this should go to her. In fact, we're thinking about next year having two checks, 10% to you, 90% to her.
Opposites attract. You think she's sweet as pie? She is. Okay, she's not. It says, love is the greatest blessing of all. Beautiful card. It says, "Dear Pastor and Amy, thinking of you today and wishing you both continuing love, laughter, friendship, and happiness every day of your lives. May the Lord give you many, happy anniversary. May the Lord give you many years together to serve him. With love, your church family." And there's a check there. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Choir. I love them.
Yeah.
429, Onward Christian Soldiers.
Let's all stand, shall we? Onward Christian Soldiers. On the first verse, Junior Church and Primary Church are being dismissed.
Thank you. times when life seems gentle and blessings flood my way, I turn my gaze away from you and soon forget to pray. But when the sky grows darker and courage turns to fear, my anxious voice cries upward with words you long to hear. Lord, I need you. When the sea of life is calm, oh Lord, I need you. When the wind is blowing strong, from you, for Lord, you are my song. Although I'm prone to wander and boast in all I do, Lord, keep my eyes turned upward so I depend on you. Lord, strong, whether trials come or cease, keep me always on my knees. Lord, I need you. Lord, I need you. Whether trials come or cease, keep me
Don't miss the message of these songs you're hearing and singing. Don't miss the message. I was already distracted. If this message doesn't come out right, it's not my fault. Because I've got a whole book full of them here, and I had one on my... And I'm just trying to listen to God, and then John Sheets gets up and blasphemes the preacher. No, and he attacked his own wife. So, Pat, I don't feel so bad because, wow. After 114 years of marriage, you can do that. I can't wait for heaven. I didn't say that when I first got saved. I was glad I'm saved. I'm still glad I'm saved. Amen. But heaven just looks better all the time. I'm really looking forward to seeing people that Amen. I've lost. Not for good. I've just lost them for a while. I'm looking forward to meeting people that I've never met. I am. We'll have a long time, sit around, talk about food. You know the greatest thing about heaven? Three words. No more night.
John. It is true. He didn't say anything that was a lie, but man, I sound like the biggest fraidy cat.
Amen.
Bears? No. Bear comes in the house, I'll wrestle him. Spiders? That's Amy's job. Or bees. Bees and no, you know, flying. Hebrews, chapter 11, Hebrews. Of course, you do it. I'll do it. I get to do it publicly. I was thinking about Amy and I when we first met and got together. April will be 42 years. I called her for the first time 42 years ago, and come April, and she didn't sound right. I said, "Are you okay?" You know, I'm beginning to think she don't want to talk to me. I was told she did. I was told I was the best thing she'd ever seen. So I called her and I said, "Yeah, something doesn't sound right." You know, and I didn't know how to say that because I'm trying to be cool. You know, I'm trying to win her over. And so she said, "Well, I'm washing my hair." I said, "Are you on the phone?" This is before cell phones. Till her mom died, they had that big black. Her dad wouldn't get rid of that phone. "Hey, these phones last forever." You know, they weighed 100 pounds. And she's on that phone under the kitchen sink washing her hair, first time I ever talked to her. And I said, "You're washing your hair right now?" Imagine how that sounded. And I said, so I said, "Well, why didn't you wait?" I was very curious. "So why should I didn't want to miss your call?" She said, "I knew you were going to call." Now, yesterday she said, "Well, I'm sorry you called 42 years ago." Hebrews chapter 11. Now she's used to me. Nobody knows me like her. It's scary. We get each other the same cards. Valentine's Day, we got each other, not the exact same card, very similar. And then yesterday we both had cards, and we pulled them out, and it's just scary. Because she's starting to think right. Hebrews 11. The guys are doing a great job. I appreciate everybody's commenting. I've not stayed home sick to watch church yet, but if I do, I'm hearing it. It looks great. I'm thankful for all those guys, Scott and Stephen. They've all pitched in and put together, you know, DVDs and of the funeral service. Man, Rod, you guys know Wendell. Whatever you need, we'll give you copies of that. We it recorded, and I'm just so thankful that all that's available. It makes things a little different. But they do a great job, and sometimes I don't get, I'm not, you know, I title every sermon, but I don't always say it, or I don't like it. It's not the issue. But let me give you this title for you and for them. The title this morning, Hebrews 11, When all you have is faith. When all you have is faith. I love the 11th chapter of Hebrews. You know that because we spent several months in Sunday school studying the one chapter. And it is just a tremendous chapter. Verse 32. Let me quote what a great man said one time. Read at my pace. Talk about John Sheets. Quoting John Sheets. Read at my pace. Really, very important. Very important. You know God wants you to read the Bible a certain way, don't you? He doesn't want you to rush through it. If you read the Bible this morning and you rushed through it, you wasted your time. Don't. And I know you think I do. I don't. Some of you are going to be surprised when you get to heaven that I'll be there. And some of you will be surprised, everything will come out. Some may be bad, but, you know, everybody thinks I pray, and jump up. Hey, my time with God, man, that's the most important thing I have. So when I read his word, when I pray, that's I'm all business. Well, I don't joke with God. When I read his word, it's not a joke. But when I'm celebrating the Christian life, I'm having fun. Yeah, I don't want there to be any liquor that makes someone feel better than how Jesus can make you feel. And I want him to do that for me. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 32. He writes, and what, after he's told us about all these people that got through life by faith, he says, and what shall I more say? I love this phrase, for the time would fail. In other words, there's not enough time to tell all that God has done. Remember, John said that about Jesus. John said in the last chapter of his gospel that if you wrote down everything Jesus did, the world couldn't contain it. That's a lot. And so the writer, whoever it is, we argued this in college. They're still arguing. I have preachers say, who do you think wrote Hebrews? And I always say, I know who wrote Hebrews. They'll go, who? God. Amen. It's all inspired by God. You guys quit wrestling about personalities. Man, when I read this, I don't go, oh, thank God for Paul or Apollos. There's those that say it was. I don't care. But, you know, I mean, I've got bigger, what's that verse? I got bigger fish to fry. Some of you are like, is that real? My dad thought those were all in there. He knows better now. Verse 32, the time would fail me to tell of Gideon, and of Barak, I'm not going to say Barak. Barak. And of Samson, and of Jephthah, of David, also in Samuel, and of the prophets. Verse 33, who, through faith, subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions. I have Daniel written next to that. That one I know. You say, well, how did Daniel stop the mouth of lions? If they threw you in a den of lions with a bunch of lions around you, would not one of your prayers be, please, Lord, take away their hunger? Please, Lord, make their teeth fall out. Please, Lord, would you not pray that God would stop? Please, Lord, give them lockjaw. Would you not be praying that? Do you believe Daniel prayed? We know he did, Daniel chapter 6, and he didn't care if it was against the law. His windows open, he pointed in the right direction, he talked to God. They said, you go to jail. He said, fine, I can pray there. You can't keep me from praying. You realize that, right? They can't say, quit praying. They can put a gun to your head and say, if you pray one more time, we'll blow you to kingdom come. Pull the trigger. I just won't have to pray then. I'll be with Jesus. Verse 34, quench the violence of fire. I'm assuming that's talking about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. You say, well, they should have just bowed down. They wouldn't have got thrown in the furnace. I don't want to read that, do you? I don't want to read that three Christians compromised their faith so they wouldn't have to go in the furnace. I want to read that they stood up for God, put God first, and then they got thrown in the furnace, and guess what? The guys who threw them in died, but they didn't in the furnace. Explain that one. Isn't that good? Some of you need to get excited about these Bible stories. You need to be childlike. You're so adult, you're not having any fun. Amy said, when you die, what do you want at your funeral? I said, a big cake. Let everybody eat. She wants M&Ms at her funeral. She said, I want you to put big bowls of M&Ms all around. I said, I can handle that. Hey, when I die, I'll be in heaven. Cry all you want. I won't be. So just get cake, eat cake. Have a dinner, celebrate, do whatever, and then Amy's going to Mexico for vacation. I told her, take some time off. You say, you know, you shouldn't joke like that. Okay, then we'll get raptured. How's that? God could take care of you when it looks impossible. Amen. What would it do to your faith if the guy standing near the furnace died? Standing near, they didn't get in, they're close to it. And those guys died. What would it say about you going in the furnace? Well, wouldn't you consider yourself a really dead duck? Wouldn't you think, man, this is going to be awful? You ever been to the dentist and heard someone screaming? That'll mess you up. You're in the waiting room. All of a sudden you hear, yeah! Are you like, I trust you, Lord. I'm like, you know, it doesn't feel that bad. I can clean my own teeth. I can get a file and a pickaxe. Clean my own teeth. Can you imagine being bound, prepared to be thrown into this fire, and the guys who are going to do that die? Be hard to have faith then, wouldn't it? I mean, you're seeing these people around the furnace die. Is your faith strengthened? No way. Listen to me. That's all we've got. And so he writes here. Verse 34, quenched, like extinguished, put out. The violence of fire. Hey, fire is violent. When it burns, man, it doesn't say, oh, we shouldn't burn up their pictures. Some of you have been in a fire, been through a fire, lost all your stuff. I love it when they have these fires or something and they go, we found one thing, a page from the Bible. Man, I just think that's so cool. Everything else burns up. Fire is violent. The smoke from fire. You know this, right? That most people that die in a fire die from smoke inhalation. Is God big enough to quench the fires in your life? He doesn't look like it when the people that are close to it are dying. You know, that's what happens. We talked about that this morning in Sunday school. Joseph, Jacob, for 20-some years, we say 22, for over 20 years, Jacob knew, he saw the bloody coat. Joseph's gone. He's dead. And it bothered him every day. And then one day, as God had said, a famine came. His brothers left Canaan, went to Egypt, got food. Joseph knew it was them. They didn't know it was him. And he was alive, but he didn't tell them. I'd be itching, John, not to keep a secret. Tell them. I'd be giving them the, hey, you know who I am? It'd be hard to be, yes, my sons. You know, and then speak, I'd have to speak a different language. All that was involved. So then, here's what happened. Finally, Joseph reveals himself. I'm Joseph. I'm alive. Tell Dad. Go tell Dad. And so they tell Jacob, and Jacob saw the bloody coat. For years, he hadn't seen Joseph, and to him, Joseph is gone. But he still knew that God gave Joseph a dream. And the dream was that the brothers and his parents would bow down, and Jacob was wrestling with what God said, because God said, hey, Joseph, someday they'll bow down. And if Joseph is dead, God isn't true. So when Jacob heard that Joseph was alive, first thought in his mind was, yeah, I'm glad. Yeah, hey, I'm glad Joseph is alive, but I'm glad God's alive. I'm glad that what God said is true. And I've got news for you. What everything God says is true. Verse 34, quench the violence of fire, escape the edge of the sword. Out of weakness were made strong, wax valiant in flight, turn to flight. The armies of the aliens, verse 35, women received their dead raised to life again, and others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. That means they believed so strongly in heaven they didn't want to live. Here. They would not accept deliverance. Don't kill me, I'll be with Jesus. That's better. And others, verse 36. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were, verse 37, they were stoned, they were sawn asunder. You imagine watching your loved ones sawn in two. You know what you better have? Not strong bones. You know what you better have? Some of you aren't getting this, are you? You know what you better have if they're going to cut you in two? Faith. And they did. Verse 37, they were tempted. They were slain with a sword. They wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, tormented, of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and mountains and dens and caves of the earth, verse 39. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, received not the promise. God, having provided some better thing for us, that they without us should not be made perfect. Listen to me. When God tells us to believe, He's asking us to do something that's unreasonable and illogical. I said at the funeral yesterday, thank God salvation isn't by works. We ought to be excited that Jesus took care of it. We don't have to work. That just thrills me. You know what faith says? Faith says, accept this without evidence and trust what you can't see. Because Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 1 says that. Now, faith is the substance, what's solid. Faith is the substance, what's solid. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. There are Christians all over our world. There are Christians all over our country. There are Christians in this room that are discouraged. They're going through hard times. They're going through struggles. They're going through trials. They're going through confusing times. They're going through suffering. We all face discouragement at one time or another in our Christian life. And thank God we have not just our faith, but we have the faith of those who have a testimony that you can trust the Lord without receiving the promise. If I was going to be a disciple, I'd love to be Peter. I'm more of a Thomas. When Jesus says to me, I love you, I always say, prove it. I mean, I want to just go, thank you, but I always go, yeah. Prove it. They didn't have a Bible. You
have a Bible? What an advantage we have that we can open up this book and read. I just love the old Naaman. I was studying Naaman, dipping in the water. You know, nobody could do anything. He didn't know what to do. Elijah says, I don't need to be there. Just run down there, dip in, you'll be fine. Naaman said, I'm not doing that. How many times have we hurt ourselves because we won't believe God? We have a Bible. It would be harder to walk by faith without a Bible. But thank God we have a Bible. A God-breathed, inspired Bible. And it says there, if you look back, verse 35, it says that they wanted to obtain. They didn't want to live. When they got tortured, they didn't say, don't torture me, I want to live. Hey, they didn't want deliverance. They wanted, verse 35, see it? A better resurrection. How did they know that? By faith? Shame on us for having in print what God wants us to know. And we act like He owes us more. We have what He said. We have what He wants us to know. This and everything He knows is what He wants us to know. Shame on us. They believed that Jesus would come. They didn't have a Bible to read that in. They believed it by faith. All they could do was walk by faith. We know. They had to say, He's coming. We look back and say, He came. It takes more faith without a Bible to believe He's coming. That's what it's talking about there when it says they received not the promise. You and I, look, it's proven He came. Easter's coming. You know what Easter is? Jesus rose from the dead. Amen. The Easter bunny didn't rise from the dead. Jesus rose from the dead. The promise is that it happened. Not only did I promise you, but I did it. Jesus said on the cross, it is finished. We need to understand faith. We need to understand faith. And there are three guys in here that teach us about faith. I want to just talk about them quickly. Three simple points. Number one, look at verse 7. Go back to verse 7. Hebrews 11, verse 7. It says, by faith, Noah. How many of you have been to Creation Museum to see the ark? I want to go. We ought to just take a big trip there and go. Imagine building that thing. Hey, that one down there in Ohio wasn't built by a guy and his sons with no power tools. It says there, verse 7, by faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. Noah teaches us that faith will get you through times that seem, here's my point, Noah teaches us that faith will get you through times that seem out of control. The Bible says God got, Genesis chapter 6, God got so mad. He had it. He said the imaginations of man, the things that man thinks and do, he said is only, these are God's words, only evil continually. You think God knows what's going on today? Think He's mad?
I mean, you tell me, if you go down the street, you see a guy building a big boat. See, well, God said he wouldn't do that anymore. I know, but hey, boy, the times are bad. Out of control. I would say if ever we lived in a time that was out of control, it's out of control. So God tells us he can't take it anymore. He tells Noah he's going to destroy all flesh. But Noah, it says there in verse 7, saved his family. The saving of his house. Because he did what God said. For 120 years, God extended mercy to mankind. While Noah, I'm trying. Got a lot on my mind. I've had 39 hard years. While Noah, some of you don't catch it. Some of you go, oh, wake up. Noah's building a boat for the sake of his house, but yes, he's doing it because God said do it, and God, for 120 years, as Noah's building the boat, is showing mankind his mercy. But after that, it's going to rain. It's going to rain for 40 days. It's going to rain for 40 nights. There'll be a great flood. It'd wipe everything out. So Noah, with precise details, builds this massive ark. Would it take faith for Noah to grasp what he was about to do? Some of you act like coming to church is like building this ark. Oh, Sunday morning, I'm tired. I was up late. I got to take a shower. I'm going to get ready. You want us to dress up. I don't want you to dress up. I think God's worth it. You quote me on this one, too. If a wedding's worth a tuxedo, God's worth more. He is. Come on, he is. Do you understand that Noah is trying to grasp? He's thinking, can I do this? And then he's thinking, should I do this? So it all has to compute by faith. God's going to destroy the whole earth. He's going to spare Noah. Yet all that Noah knew were these simple commands from God. Anybody ever asked you, hey, where's that verse? Do you know where that verse is? And if you had it, didn't you feel like a hero? It's hard when they go, where's that verse? You know, and they tell you, and you go, I don't know. You're like a dumbbell. They're thinking, they don't even read the Bible. They ask me, put me on the spot. You know, if I'm paging through a Bible that's not mine, I know where it is in my Bible. You know, listen to me. Noah didn't have a Bible that he could refer to. What God say? I better read that again. Noah had to simply accept it all by faith without. I don't think God talked to him for 120 years. I think God said, do this. He left him. He didn't talk to him for 120 years. You'd have to be awful sure that what you heard was right. Aren't you glad that you and I don't have to live like that? Aren't you glad that you and I could open up the... Aren't you glad we can quote it? Huh? Aren't you glad you know John 3:16? We'll say, hey, what's your favorite scripture? Oh, I really love John 3:16. Everybody knows that. The heathens know that. But it's still good. I think we ought to be memorizing Scripture. I think we ought to rely on Scripture. Faith demanded of Noah that he told us, verse 7, that he moved with fear, knowing God was right.
He had to keep believing when it was hard to believe, when he was tired, when he hadn't heard from God. He had to keep believing. God told him to believe what he was telling him. He wanted him to obey without any excuses. And if he ever felt like giving up or if he started to doubt, he needed to trust what God told him. Because remember, it's out of control around him. And sometimes you and I will go through that. Number two, verse 8. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out into a place which he should have to receive for an inheritance, obeyed, and he went out not knowing. Verse 8, not knowing whither he went. You need faith when it seems like everything's out of control. And number two, you need faith when you don't know what's going to happen in the future. Everybody wants to know the future. I would love, forgive me, if I go, I'll tell you. I would love to go to a psychic reader. They're still out there. I just want to take them a bad check, though, because I don't want to pay for it. So I want to say you take checks and then write them a check for my dad's account or something. Because I'm not paying money. But I want to sit down and, you know, whatever they do, read my poem or look into a crystal ball. And then I want to say, I know the future. I know exactly what's going to happen. I mean, what are they telling people? What assurance is there apart from faith? God comes to Abraham. He says, I want you to leave your country. I'm not telling you where to go. I just want you to go. When we left for Bible college, Amy and I had been married. We got married in March of 78. In April, I surrendered to full-time service for our God. In December, we packed up our stuff in a U-Haul trailer and headed north to Wisconsin. She was all for it. We didn't have a place to live. We didn't have a job. All we knew is we were supposed to be there and I was supposed to go to college. Amy's mom didn't say much, but her dad had a really hard time with that. Before we left, one of the things he said to me, he said, come here a minute. He said, let me get this straight. You're taking my daughter. You just got married. You haven't been married a year. All your stuff's in the trailer. It's snowing. Remember that? It was snowing like mad. A 4 or 5 hour trip to Watertown took us over 8 hours. It was snowing. All the mountains and hills on the way up there, there are none. But when it's snowing, everything's slippery. We were bumping the trailer just to get the trailer up the hills. And I had a car that we had to stop. I had one of those old Mazda rotary engines and the seal blew and I wanted to keep it. And so we drove it up there and we filled it full of water. We had to stop and get water in the snow and the blizzard every hour. And I'm beginning to think, you know what? Let's turn around. Amy's dad, before we left, said, so you're taking my daughter. All your stuff's in this trailer. You're leaving in this blizzard, and you're going to Wisconsin. I said, that's, yeah. And he goes, you don't have a job. I said, no. He said, you don't have a place to live. I said, no. And he's kind of giving me that look like, boy, are you dumb. I felt dumb. Hey, listen to me. The truth is, I felt dumb. But I had faith. That's when he opened up his wallet, didn't even look in there, just grabbed all the money out, put it in my hand. Man, I knew I was good to go now. Can I tell you, dozens, listen to me, keep my education. Let me tell you where I really learned. Amy and I would be on our knees praying because we couldn't pay the rent. And Amy would look to me, I'm the leader. She would say, what do we do? I would say, I don't know. What if we get kicked out? We don't have any money to go anywhere. We got to pay the rent so we can stay here. What if we, and I said, I don't know. We hadn't been married, it hadn't been a year.
So I'd say it sounded spiritual to me. I said, let's pray. We'd kneel at the we had this old crummy couch someone gave us when we first got there. We're praying. We heard, you came into our apartment. There was a hallway, and there was apartments off the hallway. And the mailbox was right out there. Dozens of times this happened. If I said it happened once, I'd be lying. Happened dozens of times. Because once you do it the first time and it works, then you go, hey, we're in trouble. Let's pray. We'd be on our knees. Her mom would call. How you guys doing? Amy would tell her, well, her mom would go, I'm sending you a check. We'd go out to the mailbox after praying. That day, rent's due. We don't know what to do. We go to the mailbox. There's a check. I don't know what to do about my school bill. I would be cutting hair in a barbershop on campus. Someone would come down and say, there's a guy on the phone. Says it's Dr. Cederholm. But he's not going to call here on a pay phone to the dorm for you. But answer and see who it is. So I get on the phone and go, hello? And he called me, Brother Rowley. Brother Rowley? It was Dr. Cederholm, and I'd go, really? And I could tell it was him. I heard his voice. I heard him preach. He sat in my barber chair. I knew it. So he goes, Brother Rowley, I need you to come to my office when you can. So I get to his office, and I'd go, man, he's going to kick me out personally. He'd look at me. He'd open a check, and he'd go, there's a check here designated to your school account. He said, it's a lot of money. I'm sure you could use it. He said, but we're putting it on your account. Listen, I wouldn't trade that for anything. You don't see the future, but God does. When God tells you to pack up, we're moving. When God said to Abraham, pack up, you're moving. Where are we going? I know you don't know, just go. Faith demanded that Abraham act on nothing more than what God promised him. Verse 8, by faith Abraham, when he was called to go out in the place which he should after receive for an inheritance, obeyed. Abraham had to keep his eyes on what God promised him. Verse 14 and 15 says, for they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. Verse 15 says, Hebrews 11, truly if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. That means when Abraham left, he didn't look back. He looked forward to what God would do for him. So God gives you enough faith to get through when things are out of control. Number two, God gives you faith to get through when things are unknown in the future. Number three, God gives you, look at verse 27. By faith, he forsook Egypt, talking about Moses. Now there's Moses. You remember him, he built an ark. Verse 27. By faith, he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. God will give you enough faith when life is out of control, and he'll give you enough faith when you don't know what the future is, but he'll also give you enough faith so that this world doesn't get a hold of you. He doesn't want you to be like the world. He doesn't want you to love the world. When God works, he delivers. He delivered the children of Israel from Pharaoh. And as they fled from him, they came and tried to overtake them at the Red Sea. And when everybody looked at the sea and said, there's nothing we can do. We're dead. This is ugly. We should have never left. God split the Red Sea. Hey. You don't have to know how God's delivering you. You just have to know he can deliver you. Yeah, I don't believe God split in the Red Sea. I believe it. I believe it. They didn't have a raft. They didn't have a bass boat. They ain't a boat anymore, right, Doug? It's a bass boat. Used to be John boats. Now it's bass boats. Rafts. Huh? We don't just, canoe. They didn't have any of that. Faith is very demanding. Once you hear God's word, You and I are supposed to obey it with no evidence. God wants us to live life with faith. By faith, through faith. That's all we have. God is all you need for every situation that life will throw at you. I told you we, in college, had no money. I cut hair. This guy still owed me money. I couldn't demand. I couldn't charge. I was on campus. It had to be free will offering. Some of those guys took advantage of it. I don't have money to pay you later. Yeah, it's later. It's been 30 years. We had no food, none. One of my buddies heard about that. Our patio's connected. Our apartments were right next. Our door was here. His front door was right next door. We had two apartments, but then we shared a little patio on the second floor. He heard we had no food. He knew that. We had been out preaching, and we didn't make any money. If we went to Milwaukee to work in the church, there was nothing. One time we came home, and while I look in the cupboards, there's nothing there. Amy opened up the cupboards, and they were full. She went through every cupboard, went to the fridge. The fridge is full. All the cupboards are full. She said, come in here. I said, why? She said, open the cupboards. I said, why? I'm already depressed. She said, open them. I opened them. They're full. She said, open the fridge. Their fault. We went to the, Stephen was born. We went to Stephen's room. There were diapers everywhere. Keep your money. Give me God. Here's where I go. Now I'm thinking, how'd this stuff get in here? I said, Amy, was the door locked? Yeah, you opened. I saw you with a key. You had to unlock it. And now I'm mad. Because somebody blessed me, but they broke in. Pretty soon, I won't say his name. He knocks on the door. Hey, you guys made it back. Great. He said, I got to tell you something. It's really bugging me. I said, what? He said, the guys from society. I was in a society in college called Didaskalos. It was the married men. He said, the guys from Didaskalos wanted to fill your cupboards in your fridge. You said you saw that, didn't you? I said, yeah. He said, and they wanted to know how to get in. And I told them that we could break into your patio door because I've tried that before and it's easy. I called his name. I said, you rotten rascal. He said, well, with a butter knife, I was able to pick your lock, get in, and we pick. Aren't you happy that they brought all that stuff? I said, don't you ever break in my house again unless you leave a big pile of money. It all boils down to one thing. Either you're going to trust God or not. College gets old and boring, and sometimes the guys ask dumb questions, and I think, what am I doing here? And I'm paying for it, and they're not, and they're messing around, and I'm in my young mid-20s, and I'm the old guy, and I'm going, hey, I'm trying to hear, because I'm paying for it, and I want to get out of here. The only thing that you and I need and have is his word. And I think the reason that we're not seeing more victory in our lives, because we're not believing him for the victory. Hey, can I say this again? Pat, take notes, because John will use this next year on our 40th anniversary. Far better men than I have failed. Far better men than I have failed. Did that compute? I keep thinking, why have I failed yet? I'll tell you why. The world was dead to Noah. He was alive to what God wanted. And I've tried to do that. But I know how easy it is for this world to become alive. Some of the greatest men I know and some of the closest friends I've had. Man, I've got buddies that could preach and love God like I've never seen. You know what they're doing? They're back at their hometowns and they're waiting tables and selling insurance and working in car washes. There's nothing wrong with that. But if God calls you to do one thing and you blow it, Moses decided to give up the whole world for what God had for him instead. And you know what I found, and I hope I keep believing? It's always worth it. It's not worth it when you turn your back on God. You always regret that. But it's always worth it when you trust God and you don't turn your back on Him. Some of you are going through times that look like they're out of control. Some of you are going through times that you're so scared of the future. Hey, listen to me. Can I say this? Doesn't matter what the doctor says. It matters what God says. It doesn't matter what the Democrats and the Republicans are doing. Let them all kill each other. Maybe that's how Jesus will come back. God's in control. It doesn't matter. Listen to me. It doesn't matter if the world looks like they're having more fun than you. Something's wrong with you because Jesus said, I came that you might have life and you might have it more abundantly. Amen. Go get drunk. Go ahead. Go on. You'll regret it. I've been drunk in 42 years, and I have no regrets. I don't think I'm missing anything. The only thing I don't want to miss is believing what God can do for me if I trust Him. Pray with me. Your head bowed. Your eyes closed. Every head bowed. Every eye closed. Our dear Lord, we fail You. We start trying to do what we can do. We start looking for what we can see. And we don't believe You. When Noah wanted to say, I can't build that ark. I think he told himself, yes, I can. God told me to do it. And He wouldn't tell me to do anything I can't do. So help us to remember, Lord, that You're not going to tell us to do anything we can't do. Even when it looks like everything is out of control. Dear Lord, help us to believe You for the future. No matter what news we get, no matter what it looks like, no matter what we think, no matter what someone else would say, we can believe You. We can have faith. When times are out of control, we can have faith for our future. And Lord, this world hounds us. It keeps telling us we're missing it. The devil told Adam and Eve, you are missing it, man. If you don't eat of this tree, you're missing it. Dear God, help us to be dead to that. Help our faith to believe what You say and not what this world keeps clamoring and yelling at us. He said, for all that is in the world is not of the Father. Help us to be dead to this world, but alive to You, alive by faith, trusting You like Moses, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to choose the pleasures of sin for a season. Speak to hearts, Lord. If anybody's here and they're not saved, if someone's here and they're not sure of heaven, would You right now take away all their peace? If they're here not saved, take away everything they have so they see that You're the only one that can give them what they need. When You said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life, that's what You're trying to say. That nothing else will work. I'm the only one that can do it. And Lord, there are people sitting here struggling, scared. Help us to trust you, Lord. Speak to hearts. Speak to ladies. Speak to men. Speak to young people. Grow them. Grow them up now in these moments. Help them to see that it's by faith. Whatever we come up against, we're going to get through it by faith. Your head bowed. Your eyes closed. Preacher, pray for me. Preacher, pray for me. God, speak to my heart. There's something he wants me. I know he wants me to respond to him regarding the issue of having faith when it seems like it's out of control, when I don't know what's coming, and when the world is just trying to get me to take everything they have. Preacher, would you pray for me? God, speak to me. Slip it high. God, speak to me. Dear Father, I pray that these dear folks and others would say yes to you, and that you would show them and bless them. Thank you for your goodness, Lord. When we do what you want, you take care of us. We always say where God guides, he provides. And I learned that. That's true. That's not just something I say. I don't use that a lot. And I believe it. But no, God takes care of us. Thank you. I ask it in Christ's name. Piano's going to play. You're standing. As you stand, if you're going to make a decision, do that quickly. God wants you to believe him for what he can do. Don't you try to do it. You just say, God, I don't know what to do. You know what to do. God, I give it to you. Take care of it. I need to believe you. I need to trust you. You come. She's playing. God speak in your heart. You need to believe him when it's out of control. You need to believe him when you don't know what's going to happen in the future. And you need to believe him when it looks like the world is very appealing to you. The world can't give you anything compared to what God can give you. Don't ever believe the lie of the world. Nothing is ever out of control. When you have God, he's always in control. And he knows the future. Trust him. I'm going to pray. Pray with me. Father, I want to have a faith that honors you. It doesn't matter what others think. They can think I'm dumb. They can think I'm just nuts. They can think that I've lost it. I just want to have a faith that honors you. There's a lot you want to do. Help me to believe you. I want to go your way. I want to accomplish what you want to accomplish. I want to believe you for everything you want to do. Thank you, Lord. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.